Hello everyone. In the last lecture, we looked at conformations of dimethyl cyclohexanes, cyclohexane diols, and few questions on how to identify the most stable conformer of a compound. Okay. In this lecture, I am going to discuss conformations of decalin, substituted decalin, cyclohexanones, and piperidine molecules. Okay, let's get to the topic. Conformations of decalin. We know decalin belongs to fused bicyclic system. See, in a bicyclic system, we have fused bicyclic system, right? So decalin is an example for fused bicyclic system. We also have spiro bicyclic systems and bridged bicyclic systems and all. But here, decalin molecule is an example for a fused bicyclic system. Okay. Then, what is the IUPAC name of decalin? The IUPAC name is, since it is a bicyclic compound, we use the prefix bicyclo. Then these two carbon atoms are fused carbon, right? These two are called fused carbon. So from so here you have two rings. In this ring we have four carbon atoms, right? Carbon 1, 2, 3, 4. Similarly, here also we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and between the fused carbon there is no carbon atoms, right? Between these two. Therefore, the name of this compound is bicyclo-4-4-0, and totally we have 10 carbon atoms, so it is called decane. Bicyclo-4-4-0 decane. This is the IUPAC name of decalin. Okay, decalin exists in two configurational isomers, cis and trans. So here I have given the planar structure of cis decalin and the trans decalin, but we know very well planar structure does not exist, okay, because planar structure involve lot of eclipse strain and angle strain, so planar structures are not possible. Okay, let's first we'll start with trans decalin. So this is the Fouquet ring form of trans decalin, where both the cyclohexane rings exist in the chair conformation. Okay, suppose if I take this ring as A and this ring as B, and this is the numbering system, right? So, right, so in transdecalin, so the transdecalin, the numbers goes like this, right? This is number 1, 2, 3, 4, then this is 5, 6, 7, 8, then we'll give number 9 and 10 for the fused carbon atoms. Here we have two hydrogen, right? This hydrogen is axial with respect to the cyclohexane, and this also axial, so both are exactly opposite to each other, therefore it is a trans decalin. Okay, are you clear? Then a trans decalin is a rigid molecule, right? It does not undergo ring flipping. It does not undergo ring flipping. Why? What is the reason? The reason is in the chair form of, suppose you take this form of this ring A. With respect to ring A, see this bond is equatorial, and this bond also equatorial. So both these bonds are equatorial. So when it undergo ring flipping, both the ring has to undergo ring flipping. So if this ring undergo ring flipping, this equatorial bond is supposed to become axial, right? When both the bond goes to axial, what will happen? Angle strain, right, will come into the picture. That angle strain, that excessive angle strain, right, destabilize that particular conformation. That is why this transdecalin, right, does not undergo ring flipping. Are you able to follow? Right. So ring flipping converts this equatorial bonds into axial bonds, which introduce severe angle strain in the molecule. Right. So to avoid this, transdecalin does not undergo ring flipping. Right? Are you clear? Then Transdecalin belongs to C2H point group. Just keep this information. I'm not going to discuss about the point group and all. Okay, just for information purpose, I'm giving. So say, this transdecalin belongs to C2H point group. In C2H point group, we have a plane of symmetry. Whenever molecule possesses plane of symmetry, it must be a chiral. Okay, so transdecalin is a chiral. And moreover, when the two rings fuse together, okay, the ring fused carbons, right, are the in the fused carbon, along the fused carbon, there won't be any additional butane-Ghosh interactions introduced, okay, in the molecule. So what I'm saying here, see bond and this bond, they are anti to each other, right? Similarly, this bond and this bond, they are also anti, right? So here, the fusion of the two ring does not introduce any additional butane-Ghosh interaction in the molecule, okay? So since there is no additional butane-Ghosh interaction, the potential energy of this conformation, transdecalin, potential energy of transdecalin is assumed to be zero. Okay. Now, we'll discuss cystecalin. So this is the planar structure of cystecalin. Okay. Just for comparison purpose, I have taken this planar structure. So I will take this as ring A, this is ring B. Right. This is the planar structure. Now I'm going to draw the Puckett ring form of cystecalin. See, in the Puckett ring form, both the rings exist in chair form, but now what happens? See, this is the numbering, right? This is, take this as ring A, this is ring B, and this is the numbering system 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Now, see, with respect to, with respect to this cyclohexane, right? The ring A, with respect to the ring A, this bond, an equatorial bond, am I right? This hydrogen is in equatorial, and with respect to this carbon, this hydrogen is axial. So in 1-2 position, if one hydrogen present axial, the other hydrogen present equatorial, it should be a cis isomer. Are you able to understand this? Yeah, so this conformation, right, or this structure is the structure of cis-decalin, right? Then cis-decalin is flexible. See, unlike transdecalin, you know very well, I told you transdecalin is rigid, whereas cisdecalin is flexible in nature and undergoes ring flipping. Why it undergoes ring flipping? See here, in ring A, with respect to ring A, this bond, see this bond, the bond between 8 and 9 carbon. This bond is axial bond, am I right? Yeah, this bond is axial. What about this bond? The bond between carbon number 10 and carbon number 5, this is actually equatorial bond. So, with respect to the ring A, this bond is axial, this bond is equatorial. Suppose if ring flipping occurs, right, suppose a ring flipping occurs in B, right? Actually, during ring flipping, both the ring undergo ring flipping. So, in B, this bond supposed to go to equatorial and this bond supposed to go to axial position, right? But it doesn't make any difference, right, when you do ring flipping, because axial equatorial, ring becomes another axial equatorial. Therefore, the stability, there is no change in stability. So, ring flipping is possible in cis-decalin. Are you able to understand? Yeah. So, here I have shown the ring flipping of cis-decalin. Okay. So, I'll take this conformation. Right, let us denote this conformation as A, right, and this is carbon number 10, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now, when you do ring flipping, what will happen? Both the ring undergoes flipping. Now, suppose if this ring undergoes flipping, what will happen? Carbon number 7 will come down and carbon number 10 will go up, am I right? So, 7 will come down and 10 will go up, right? Taking this ring conformation as such, now what I am doing, we have to draw the ring, this ring also in chair form, okay, but it is very difficult to draw the chair conformation of this ring on paper. So I am showing the structure like this. Are you able to follow? So it doesn't mean that this ring is a planar ring. No, this ring is also in chair form, but but it is very difficult to draw the chair form of this ring on paper, so I am showing like this. Now, if you do rotation of this molecule, right, by 60 degree in anti-clockwise, right, if you do anti-clockwise rotation, right, by 60 degree, what will happen? This 9 post carbon will come down right here. It is a down carbon, right? And this is upward carbon, it's a downward carbon. This carbon, if you do 60 degree rotation, this carbon will come here, but it will go down. Then carbon number 9 will go up. Are you able to follow? And you will get a structure like this, right? And now this ring can be shown in a chair form, right? This ring can be shown in a chair form like this. Are you able to follow? Now, you rotate this molecule 180 degree, right? Throughout like this. If you do rotation in 180 degree in clockwise like this, what will happen? The entire molecule rotates, so you will get a conformation like this. Okay, just observe this carefully so that you can easily understand, right, how this rotation occurs. Now, listen, since it is a rigid rotation, full rotation, right, the conformation of B, right, and conformation of this structure are one and the same. I'm not doing any ring flipping, I'm just rotating the entire molecule. Therefore, this conformation and this conformation, this are all same. So this is also B. Okay. Why I have done this? Because I'm going to explain some important aspects. So this information is required for that. Okay. This information is required for some purpose. So I'm doing this. Okay. There. So this is the ring flipping in decalin. Then, now I'll take this conformation A, right? Conformation of A. Now draw its mirror image. So this is the mirror image of A. Now we need to identify whether the two mirror images, see, this is the compound A, the conformation A, and this is the mirror image of A. Now I want to analyze whether the two are superimposable or not. What to do? Yeah, I told you already there are different methods available. Now I'm going to show you a method. Listen, what you have to do? Rotate this molecule 180 degree. Okay, rotate this molecule 180 degree. So what will happen? If I rotate by 180 degree, like this or like this, right? Anyway, 180 degree, what will happen? See, you will get this molecule completely turns and appears like this. Now see this. Don't worry about the numbers. See this here. This ring is attached with this carbon and this carbon. Okay. Listen, just for clarity purpose, I have given the structure like this. Here, this 8 and 9 bond is supposed to appear in front, and the bond 10 and 5, right, it appears behind. Are you able to follow? So here, see this, this ring is attached with this carbon and this carbon. Whereas, the conformation looks alike, but this ring is attached with this carbon and this carbon. Are you able to understand? So if you take this structure as such, and if you superimpose on this, definitely the two structures do not superimpose. So this conformation A and its mirror image are non-superimposable. I repeat once again, when you take a mirror image, when you draw a mirror image, and if you rotate this molecule, and if you rotate the molecule as a whole, right? The conformation does not change. So this conformation and this conformation are one and the same. Are you able to understand? Listen, here what I'm saying is the bond between 10 and 5 is actually behind the plane. It's supposed to be like this. Now, if you observe carefully this structure and this structure, okay, they never superimpose. So these two are non-superimposable mirror images. Right? So since the conformation A and its mirror image are non-superimposable, therefore conformation A must be chiral conformation. Then the mirror image of A is exactly equivalent to B. See this? See this conformation? When you do ring flipping, we get B, right? The conformation of B, don't worry about the numbers. See the structure. This conformation B and the mirror image of A, they are equivalent. So what does it indicate? This indicates that ring flipping converts one enantiomer into another enantiomer. Okay.
So ring flipping converts one enantiomer into another enantiomer. Okay, therefore we always get non-resolvable DL pair. Right. So ring flipping converts one enantiomer into another enantiomer. Therefore, the A and B. Okay, this ring flipping isomers A and B, A isomer and B isomer. So if this is the given isomer, and this should be the mirror image. So ring flipping converts one enantiomer into another enantiomer. So A and B are enantiomers and they are interconvertible. Therefore, A and B are also conformational enantiomers. And A and B, they are equally stable. Both are cis decalene. So they are equally stable, exist in 50-50 amount. Therefore, we always end up with a racemic mixture. Okay. So cis decalene, though it is chiral, okay, it forms non-resolvable DL pair, so it is optically inactive. Okay, what is mean by this? Suppose if I take pure D isomer of cis decalene, right? Immediately the pure D, 50% of D isomers will become L isomer. So it will become racemic then. And it is very difficult to separate them because they are by ring flipping, they interconvert each other. So the cis decalene always remains as racemic mixture. Therefore, it is optically inactive. Are you able to follow? Then, cis decalene belongs to C2 point group. I have told you already, when molecule belongs to C1 or CN, or molecule belongs to C1 or CN or DN point groups, DN, then those molecules are supposed to be chiral. So cis decalene is chiral, but it is optically inactive, right? Because it forms non-resolvable DL pair. Then A and B are conformational enantiomers. I have told you already. Then in cis decalene, okay, the fusion of these two rings will introduce three additional butane gauge interactions. What are they? See, C2, C1. C9 and C8. This is one butane gauge interaction. This is one butane gauge interaction. Then C4, C10, C5 and C6 will give another butane gauge interaction. Then C4, C10, C9 and C8 will give another butane gauge. So there are three butane gauge interactions exist. 3 into, and the energy of each butane gauge interaction is roughly 0.9. So 3 into 0.9 is 2.7 kilocalorie per mole. I showed you already that for transdecalene, there is no additional butane gauge interaction. So, for transdecalene, potential energy is assumed to be zero. With respect to transdecalene, compared to transdecalene, cisdecalene has 2.7 kilocalorie per mole of energy greater. Are you able to understand? Okay, so this shows that transdecalene is more stable over cisdecalene. And what is the energy difference? The energy difference is 2.7 kilocalorie per mole for decalene molecule. Okay, so this is the energy difference between cis isomer and trans isomer of decalene. Now, suppose if I introduce a methyl group at the fused carbon, say carbon number 9 or carbon number 10, right? If I introduce a methyl group or any other alkyl group in carbon 9 or carbon 10, what will happen? The ring become rigid. So now, in this case, the trans-decalene, trans-9-methyl-decalene and cis-9-methyl-decalene, both are rigid. They do not undergo ring flipping. Okay, ring flipping is not possible in both the cases. Now, but the introduction of the methyl group, suppose if we introduce methyl group at position number 9, right, you will get a cis isomer and a trans isomer. So now we are going to see conformations of 9-methyl-decalene. So in the trans isomer, the introduction of the methyl group at position 9 will introduce 4 additional butane gauge interaction in the molecule. What are the 4 additional butane interactions? See, CH3, C9, C8, C7. This is one butane gauge interaction. Okay, then CH3, C9, C1, C2. This is another butane gas interaction. Then CH3, C9, C10, C4. This is another butane gas interaction. Then CH3, C9, C10, C5. This is another butane gas interaction. So the moment or the when you introduce a methyl group at position 9 or 10, okay, right, the molecule gets 4 additional butane gas interactions. Because of this, the energy of the conformer will increase. So 4 into the energy of each butane gas interaction is roughly 0.9. So 4 into 0.9, it comes out as 3.6 kilocalorie per mole. Are you able to follow? And these are the butane gas interactions I have given for your reference. Now, when you introduce a methyl group at position 9 in cis decaline, okay, so you will get cis 9 methyl decaline. In cis 9 methyl decaline, there are 5 additional butane gas interactions exist. What are they? See, C2, C1, C9, C8, this is one butane gas interaction. C4, C10, C5, C6, another butane gas interaction. C4, C10, C9, C8. Listen, these 3 butane gas interactions are already there in cis decaline. Now, the introduction of the methyl group at position 9 will give 2 more additional interactions. What are they? CH3, C9, C8, C7. This is one butane gas interaction. Then CH3, C9, C10, C5. This is another butane gas interaction. Okay. So now this cis 9 methyl decaline has 5 additional butane gas interactions. So 5 into 0.9, it is roughly 4.5 kilocalorie per mole of energy. Now, see, now again, the transdecaline is more stable because the energy of the transdecaline is less. The transdecaline is more stable over cis decaline. So introduction of alkyl group at position 9 or position number 10, okay, it does not change the stability. Stability of transdecaline, stability is always like this. Transdecaline is more stable over cis decaline. But what is the information that I like to give here is, if you take the difference in energy, 4.5 minus 3.6, it comes out as 0.9 kilocalorie per mole. Listen, what is the importance of this? Important is, listen, in the case of decaline, the energy difference is 2.7. The energy difference between cis and trans is 2.7. Whereas in the case of 9 methyl decaline, the energy difference is 0.9 kilocalorie per mole. So the inference here is, when you introduce a methyl group at position 9, okay, the energy difference between cis and the trans isomer decreases. Are you able to follow? Yeah, the next molecule that we are going to discuss is cyclohexanone. First I'll compare the chair conformations of cyclohexane and cyclohexanone. Then we'll discuss some important informations on cyclohexanone. Okay. See, in the planar form, the bond angle is not 109.5 degree. I'm sorry. The interior bond angle is 120 degree in the case of cyclohexane. 120 degree. When this is planar form. In planar form, the interior bond angle is 120. When it forms Puckel ring, that is in chair form, this bond angle is 111.5 degree. Okay. And now, you know very well, this is actually sp3 carbon. For sp3 carbon, the actual bond angle is supposed to be 109.5 degree. Now it comes very close to this, correct? It's very, they are close. So, what is the difference? The difference is only 2. So, only 2 degree difference is there. Because of this 2 degree, some angle strain is there in chair conformation also, no doubt. Now, if you go to cyclohexanone, in planar form, okay, the interior bond angle is 120 degree. When you take the Puckel ring form, that is in chair form, the bond angle here is 115 degree. It's an experimental value. Now, in carbonyl group, this carbon is sp2 carbon. For sp2 carbon, normal bond angle should be 120. Normal bond angle should be 120 degree. Okay. But now the angle is only 115. So what is the difference? The difference is 5 degree. Very clear. So here difference is 2, here difference is 5. You know very well, when the difference is more, angle strain also more. Therefore, in chair form of cyclohexanone, right, we have greater angle strain or larger angle strain compared to chair form of cyclohexane, right? Then, so the stability, if you compare the stability of chair form of cyclohexane and chair form of cyclohexanone, no doubt, chair form of cyclohexane is more stable than cyclohexanone. In cyclohexanone, one more information is we should consider here. What is that? Listen, suppose if carbonyl carbon is number 1, this is carbon 2, right, this is 3, 4, 5, and this carbon is 6, okay. Now listen, the equatorial hydrogens present at carbon 2 and carbon 6, these equatorial hydrogens, right, they eclipse with the carbonyl bond. So due to this eclipse strain, right, again the energy of this conformer slightly increases. So stability again decreases. So the stability of cyclohexanone, okay, decreases by two important factors. One is the angle strain, the other one is the eclipsing interaction between the carbonyl group and the equatorial hydrogen present at carbon number 2 and carbon number 6. Are you clear? So chair form of cyclohexanone is less stable compared to chair form of cyclohexane. And the point group of cyclohexanone is CS. You know, real CS point group has a plane of symmetry. So since cyclohexanone has plane of symmetry, it must be achiral. Right? Yeah. Listen, in cyclohexanone, ring flipping occurs faster. Okay, it's an experimental observation. Right? Ring flipping in cyclohexanone is faster compared to ring flipping in cyclohexane. Okay? Yeah. Then. In cyclohexanone, we have to learn two important effects. One is called 2-alkyl ketone effect, and another one is 3-alkyl ketone effect. What is meant by this? Suppose if I introduce a methyl group at two positions, see, in cyclohexanone, right? If I introduce a methyl group at two position, right, this will introduce the introduction of methyl group at two position, right, will cause some effect in the molecule, right. This is called 2-alkyl ketone effect. We are going to discuss that. Now listen, for this purpose, first I will take cyclohexane, right. If you introduce a methyl group, we'll take a methyl cyclohexane, right? In methyl cyclohexane, the methyl group may exist in equatorial position or in axial position. When methyl group is in equatorial, there is no interactions, no diaxial interaction, no butane gas interaction. Therefore, potential energy of this conformation is assumed to be zero. I'll take this energy as E1. Suppose if this methyl group exists in axial position, right, now due to 1,3 diaxial interaction, it has 1,3 diaxial interaction, and it also has 2 additional butane gas interaction. Therefore, the energy of this conformation is roughly 3.6 kilocalorie per mole. You know very well, each butane gas interaction is 0.9, and each 1,3 diaxial interaction between hydrogen and methyl also 0.9. Therefore, you'll get the energy, total energy, as 3.6 kilocalorie per mole. So what is the difference in energy? Difference in energy between the axial methyl cyclohexane and the equatorial methyl, axial and equatorial, is 3.6 kilocalorie per mole. I'll take this as A and this as B. Now, if you go to cyclohexanone, right, in the chair form of cyclohexanone, if methyl group exists in equatorial position, right, what will happen? In chair form of cyclohexanone, we have angle strain already, okay. Apart from this angle strain, now we have the eclipsed strain between the carbonyl group and the equatorial methyl. So, due to this angle strain and the eclipse strain, okay, the equatorial methyl cyclohexanone, the energy of this conformer never be zero. Okay, so it should be, suppose I'll take the energy of this conformer as E3, so E3 never be zero, because we have some interactions, right? Therefore, the energy of E3 should be greater than E1 compared to the equatorial methyl cyclohexane, right? Then, in the case of axial conformer, suppose if methyl group is present in axial position, see, this eclipse interaction does not occur. Okay, so no eclipse interaction. But we have 1,3 diaxial interaction and we have butane-Ghosh interactions. We also have some angle strain also. Therefore, energy of this conformer, see E4, since this angle strain, this eclipse strain, you know very well, eclipse strain is the dominant strain. Since eclipse strain disappears, right, the energy of this system decreases in larger extent. So, though this, but if you compare this and this, see here we have one side diaxial interaction, butane-Ghosh interaction. So the same interactions are also here. But additionally, we have angle strain. Therefore, the energy of this conformer, right, is slightly greater compared to the E2. Are you able to follow? Now, I'll show this in a vectorial form. So, this is the this is actually methyl cyclohexane, and this is methyl cyclohexanone, and this is the equatorial conformer, and this is axial conformer. So, equatorial conformer, the energy is almost zero. This is zero. Okay. The energy of B is somewhat high. Okay. So, there is a gap between these two. The energy gap is delta EAB. This is the energy difference between the axial methyl cyclohexane and equatorial methyl cyclohexane. If you go to cyclohexanone, methyl cyclohexanone, when methyl group is present in equatorial position, okay, energy is not zero, I told you. Okay, energy of the equatorial methyl cyclohexanone, see, energy of the equatorial methyl cyclohexanone due to angle strain and eclipse strain interaction, energy of the equatorial methyl cyclohexanone is not zero, it is somewhat greater, actually more greater compared to E1, okay. So compared to E1, this is E1, compared to E1, right, this E3 is greater. Then, similarly, if you compare E2, that is axial methyl cyclohexane, energy of axial methyl cyclohexane, and E4, energy of axial methyl cyclohexanone, if you compare, right, 1,3 diaxial interaction and 2 additional butane-Ghosh interaction, these interactions also are present here. Additionally, we have angle strain. Therefore, E4 is slightly greater than E2 because of the angle strain. Okay, so because of angle strain, the energy of the axial conformer of cyclohexanone is slightly greater compared to the axial conformer of cyclohexane. So this is E2, this is E2, and this is E4. Okay, E4 is slightly greater. Now, what happens? See, if you compare this gap with this gap, definitely, because see, this, if you compare these two, this equatorial conformer has higher energy compared to E1, whereas here the axial conformer energy is slightly greater than this. Therefore, the gap is very small. Are you able to understand this? So the gap between equatorial and axial conformer of cyclohexanone, methyl cyclohexanone, is less compared to the energy difference between equatorial and axial methyl cyclohexane, right? This reduction in energy difference between the axial and equatorial 2-methyl cyclohexanone compared to methyl cyclohexane, this is methyl cyclohexane, compared to methyl cyclohexane is called 2-alkyl ketone effect. So what's the meaning? The meaning is very simple. When you introduce a methyl group at position number 2 in cyclohexanone, the energy difference between axial conformer and the equatorial conformer is reduced compared to the energy difference between the axial methyl and axial methyl cyclohexane and equatorial methyl cyclohexane. This reduction in energy difference is called 2-alkyl ketone effect. You can also give the explanation in other way. Listen, suppose if you consider the ring flipping in methyl cyclohexane, so this is not bond. Sorry, this is not bond. So if you compare the ring flipping in methyl cyclohexane, this is axial methyl cyclohexane. When ring flipping occurs, you will get equatorial. Listen, here equatorial percentage, right, is extremely high, above 99.9%. Okay, this is wrong. Sorry, equatorial percentage is above 99.9%, and the axial percentage will be less than 1%. Right, so the percentage of A will be less than one, axial percentage. If you go to methyl cyclohexanone, 2-methyl cyclohexanone, listen, in equatorial form, there will be eclipse strain. Because of this eclipse strain, the stability of this conformation is somewhat less. It is more stable than this, but the eclipse strain is there. Are you able to understand? Whereas that eclipse strain is relieved or absent in the axial methyl cyclohexanone. Therefore, some substantial increase in the percentage of axial isomer exists in 2-methyl cyclohexanone. Are you able to understand this? Okay, the percentage of axial methyl cyclohexanone increases in considerable amount. Right? This increase in the percentage of axial methyl cyclohexanone, right, is what we called as 2-alkyl ketone effect, because we are introducing the alkyl group at second position. Actually, axial alkyl group percentage should be less than 1, right? But in the case of cyclohexanone, when introduce methyl group, right, at axial position, the eclipse interaction does not occur. Therefore, some considerable percentage of axial isomer is formed. So, the percentage of X here is greater than the percentage of A. Are you able to follow? What is percentage of A? Percentage of A is the axial methyl cyclohexane. Here, percentage of X means axial methyl cyclohexanone. If you compare these two, the percentage of X is greater. This increase in the percentage of axial isomer in cyclohexanone, right, is what we called as 2-alkyl ketone effect. Right? Then, this ketone effect, alkyl ketone effect, is also observed when you introduce a methyl group at third position. Okay? So, as like before, I will take the methyl cyclohexane first. This is the equatorial isomer. Let us take this isomer as A, and the energy of this isomer is 0, and this isomer has some energy, it is 3.6. So the energy difference is 3.6 kilocalorie per mole. Okay. Now, if you introduce a methyl group in the third position of cyclohexane, you will get 3-methyl cyclohexane. In 3-methyl cyclohexane, we have equatorial conformer and the axial conformer. Listen, in the equatorial conformer, there is no interactions. Okay, but we have small angle strain, right? Due to angle strain, energy of this conformer, suppose you take the energy of this conformer as E3, so E3 is slightly greater than E1. Then E3 is slightly greater than E1 due to angle strain. Now, this is E1 and this is E3. So, if you compare these two, this is equatorial cyclohexane, this is equatorial methyl cyclohexanone, right? If you compare these two, the energy of the equatorial methyl cyclohexanone is slightly greater than E1. Then, when ring flipping occurs, okay, or if you consider the axial methyl cyclohexanone, in axial methyl cyclohexanone here, we have 1,2, 1,3 diaxial interactions. Whereas here, listen, since this carbonyl group is flattened, okay, with respect to this plane, due to this flattering effect, this carbonyl group is slightly moved away. Therefore, the 1,3 diacetyl interaction exists only between this methyl and this hydrogen, and there is no interaction between the methyl group and the carbonyl group. So in this case, 1,3 diacetyl interaction is reduced compared to this, right? Since this 1,3 diacetyl interaction is reduced, right, the energy of the this conformer, axial methyl cyclohexanone E4, is almost equal to the energy of this conformer, the axial methyl cyclohexane. Are you able to follow? So now if you compare the energy of these two, so this is methyl cyclohexane and this is 3-methyl cyclohexanone, and this is the energy of the equatorial conformer, which is close to 0, and this is around 3.6. Now if you go to equatorial conformer of 3-methyl cyclohexanone, in 3-methyl cyclohexanone, due to angle strain, this energy increases slightly. Whereas if you take the axial conformer of 3-methyl cyclohexanone and the axial conformer of methyl cyclohexane, right, they are almost close, because in this conformation 1,3 diacetyl interaction is absent. Therefore, the gap between these two is less compared to this. Are you able to follow? This reduction in the energy difference of equatorial and axial conformers of 3-methyl cyclohexanone compared to the equatorial and axial methyl cyclohexane is what we called as 3-alkyl ketone effect. See, this reduction in the energy difference between axial and equatorial 3-methyl cyclohexanone compared to methyl cyclohexane is called 3-alkyl ketone effect. We can also give the effect in the other way. Listen, here ring flipping occurs. When ring flipping occurs, the equatorial become axial, right? But the axial conformation has very high energy. Therefore, the percentage of B in this mixture, right, will be very, very less. It is actually less than 1%. Whereas, if you go to 3-methyl cyclohexanone, due to ring flipping, equatorial become axial. Now, in the equatorial conformation, we have angle strain. In the axial conformation, compared to methyl cyclohexane, in methyl cyclohexane, we have 2,1,3 diacetyl interaction. Whereas, in axial methyl cyclohexanone, we have only 1 diaxial interaction. So, 1 diaxial interaction is less compared to methyl cyclohexane. Therefore, compared to axial methyl cyclohexane, this 3-methyl cyclohexanone, the percentage of this isomer slightly increases. This substantial increase in the percentage of axial 3-methyl cyclohexanone is what we called as 3-alkyl ketone effect. This is the other way of giving explanation for 3-alkyl ketone effect. So you can give the explanation based on energy difference or based on the percentage. Are you able to understand? So the percentage of Y is somewhat greater compared to the percentage of B. Are you able to follow? This is called 3-alkyl ketone effect. The next important effect in cyclohexanone is alpha halo ketone effect. What is this? Conformational study of alpha halo cyclohexanone, right? If we have halogen at the alpha position, that conformation studies reveals that conformation with the axial halogen is more stable than that with the equatorial halogen. Why? And this is what we called as alpha halogen ketone effect. Alpha halo ketone effect. So, if you take the equatorial isomer and the axial isomer, in the equatorial isomer, we have eclipse strain and there is a dipole-dipole repulsion also, right? See, this is the dipole, negative end of the dipole, and this is positive end. Now, in this dipole, this is negative end and this is positive end. Now, between these two, see, since these two charges are same, there will be repulsion. This dipole-dipole repulsion reduce the stability of the conformer. Are you able to understand? Then, So in equatorial halocyclohexanone, there is an eclipse strain between carbonyl group and the equatorial halogen, and there is a dipole-dipole repulsion between the carbonyl oxygen and the halogen, okay, because both carry partial negative charges. So repulsion exists between these two. That repulsion decreases the stability of the conformer. Whereas in the axial conformation, okay, the eclipsed strain is absent and there is no, and the dipole-dipole repulsion also reduced. Okay, so no eclipsed strain, no dipole-dipole repulsion. Therefore, this axial conformer is more stable than the equatorial conformer. Okay, so when we introduce an halogen atom in the alpha position, right, halogen prefers to occupy axial position in the conformer. This is what we called as alpha halo ketone effect. So when you introduce halogen atom in the alpha position of cyclohexanone, that halogen prefers to occupy axial position, right? This is called alpha halo ketone effect. In polar solvent, the percentage of equatorial conformation increases, right? See, in the equatorial conformation, the dipole-dipole repulsion, right? Dipole-dipole repulsion destabilizes the system. But when you go to polar solvent, right, the halogen atom and the oxygen atom, they get solvated. This solvated atoms, right, between these two, now repulsion reduced. Because of solvation, the repulsion reduced. When the repulsion reduced, then the percentage of this equatorial conformation increases slightly. This supports that, okay, there is a dipole-dipole repulsion exists between these two, between the carbonyl group and the halogen atom. Are you able to understand this? So what is alpha halo ketone effect? When we introduce an halogen atom in the alpha position of cyclohexanone, that halogen prefers to occupy axial position. This is called alpha halo ketone effect. Then the next molecule that we are going to discuss is conformations of piperidine. You know very well, the sp3 nitrogen, right, when nitrogen is attached with three different groups with a lone pair, what will happen? It will undergo pyramidal inversion. What is pyramidal inversion? These three groups will go up and the lone pair will come down, right? This is called pyramidal inversion. This pyramidal inversion occurs freely in tertiary amines, secondary amines, as well as in ammonia. Okay. Now, this is piperidine molecule. Right? Piperidine molecule also exists in chair form. Now, in the chair form, this hydrogen and the lone pair, okay, if hydrogen may occupy axial position or hydrogen may occupy equatorial position, among the two, which is more stable, right? Listen, I already told you, lone pair should be considered as an empty space. Okay, if it is an empty space, then the diaxial interaction, actually diaxial interaction is very, very poor, but even then, since this is an empty space, the diaxial interaction is almost negligible. Whereas here, some small interaction exists between these two hydrogen. Therefore, this conformation, that is conformation with the equatorial hydrogen, is more stable over conformation with the axial hydrogen in the case of piperidine. Are you able to understand? Then, ring flipping occurs in piperidine also. Because of ring flipping, what will happen? The axial equatorial hydrogen become axial hydrogen. For this ring flipping, the energy barrier for ring flipping is 42.3 kilojoule per mole. In piperidine, pyramidal inversion also possible. Because of pyramidal inversion, what will happen? The lone pair will come to equatorial position and the hydrogen will go to axial position. Right? So, the pyramidal inversion requires the energy barrier for pyramidal inversion is 25.5 kilojoule per mole. So, it means pyramidal inversion occurs faster compared to ring flipping here. Okay? Then, Suppose instead of hydrogen, if I introduce a methyl group on nitrogen, it is called N-methyl piperidine. In the N-methyl piperidine, the methyl group may occupy axial position or equatorial position. Okay. In axial position, there will be 1,3-diaxial interaction, but in equatorial methyl group, right, the 1,3-diaxial interactions are absent. Therefore, equatorial methyl piperidine is more stable over axial. Now, this is a very important molecule in piperidine. This molecule will give some information about conformations of piperidine. Suppose, if you take 1,3, this is carbon number 1, this is 1, this is position 2, this is 3. In 1,3 dimethyl piperidine, right, we have cis isomer and trans isomer. First, I will consider the ring flipping. Okay, so this is the diequatorial cis of 1,3 dimethyl piperidine. In diequatorial cis, when diequatorial cis undergoes ring flipping, what will happen? In ring flipping, the equatorial bonds become axial bonds. So, because of ring flipping, both these methyl group will take axial position. So, now this isomer, now we will get a diaxial cis. Okay, so ring flipping converts diequatorial cis into diaxial cis. So, cis remains cis, but only conformation changes. Are you able to follow? Then, suppose if 1,3 dimethyl piperidine undergoes pyramidal inversion. Pyramidal inversion occurs only at nitrogen, right? So, what will happen? Only this methyl group become axial. So, now what happens? This methyl is axial and this methyl is equatorial. This conformer is called a trans conformer. It is a trans isomer. So, pyramidal inversion converts cis isomer into trans. You know very well, cis trans isomers are configurational isomers. So, pyramidal inversion leads to configurational isomers, whereas ring flipping leads to conformational isomerism. In ring flipping, cis remains cis, whereas in pyramidal inversion, cis become trans. Are you able to follow? Okay, so this is the information I like to give in piperidine. Yeah, okay, I stop here. Thank you.